Welcome to my presentation and best greetings from Fraunhofer FEP in Dresden to the Vacuum Society all over the world. I'm pleased to get the opportunity to present our recent results for synthesizing porous films by vacuum deposition. This is the outline of the talk. I don't want to lose time and I won't directly start with the motivation. Some demands for fabrication processes of porous layers are listed here. For various application fields, such films are needed to improve the device performance, for instance in microelectronics. In chemistry, porous films are used as catalysts or for separating materials. The most growing interest will be established for energy conversion applications, such as supercapacitors or high-performance anodes in lithium-ion batteries. Several approaches to porosify materials were persuaded in past. This includes, for example, the deposition of designated materials on a template structure and subsequent template removal, as it illustrated in the upper part. Other authors report about methods producing compact alloy material via casting processes and removing the component by thermal annealing in the so-called dealloying procedure. Our approach consists of the deposition of compound layer in the first step. The compound layer consists of zinc for templating the structure and a designated material. In this case, we investigated the material silicon, nickel and carbon separately. The resulting structure depends substantially on the material selection. One can roughly distinguish between immiscible and miscible material compositions. The diagram on the left-hand side shows the phase diagram for the component silicon and zinc. As you may see, the mutual solubilities of zinc and silicon in the solid state are negligible. Therefore, separated grains of pure elements are formed during the layer growth process. This is shown on the illustration above. Whereas, the phase diagram in the nickel-zinc system on the right-hand side shows that the material are immiscible in a narrow composition region. Furthermore, grains of different solid solution and intermetallic phases can be found. In case of carbon, the data situation have been published barely and no phase diagram is available. In the second step, the compound layers will be annealed in vacuum. The diagram in the middle shows that the vapor pressure curves and melting points of zinc and designated materials silicon, nickel and carbon differs to several orders of magnitude. Consequently, annealing of deposited layers in vacuum at adequate temperatures leads to a re-evaporation and expelling of zinc. This process will be called dealloying. In case of silicon and zinc, this results in a general generation of pores at the locations of the former zinc grains, which is illustrated on the left-hand side. For partly miscible components, reorder mechanisms occur during the re-evaporation, and due to shrinking effects, pores may be formed. Now I want to present our used experimental setup. On the right-hand side, there is shown a schematic of the equipment and the used components, which were installed in the FEP vacuum tool EMU. It consists of a transport system for a carrier, and at this carrier, the substrate were arranged side by side. We used metal sheets, as well as small discs of copper and stainless steel as substrates. In the first step, the carrier is moved to the left station for substrate pretreatment by inverse butter etching. Afterwards, the carrier will be moved to the deposition station in the middle position. The deposition equipment consists of two vapor sources, one for the designated materials, silicon, nickel or carbon, and the other one for zinc. The vapor sources are placed in the lower side of the tool. They were heated by an electron beam which offered a power of 4 to 12 kilowatts. The evaporation rate was determined in situ by a rate measurement system of the crucibles. Finally, after deposition process, the substrate were transferred to the heating station on the right-hand side. The substrate were annealed at two temperatures between 500 and 750 centigrade for a time period of 30 minutes for the zinc re-evaporation. Due to the side-by-side substrate arrangement, we could investigate different composition contents with one coating experiment. For deposition process, the vapor stream is mixed in the coating region and compound material condenses on substrate. The vapor flux of each source depends on the propagation direction and is proportional to a cosine term. And thus, the deposition rate differs for the lateral position of the side-by-side substrate arrangement. This diagram shows the measured static deposition rates versus the side-by-side sample position for silicon in blue triangles, for zinc in red squares, and for silicon zinc compound layers in purple diamonds. An approximation of the data could be achieved by a curve fitting resulting from the measured evaporation rates. And with our experimental setup, we could vary the zinc concentration in the range of 10 to 50 atomic percent. We also measured the concentration by EDS, which will be presented by color numericals within the next slides. But now we want to focus on samples at these two marked coating positions with different composition concentrations. This slide shows scanning electron micrographs in the backscattered mode at the two highlighted positions. The cross-sections show 5 to 8 micrometer thick silicon zinc compound layers with material contrast. That means zinc is highlighted by brighter regions. For the upper row, the deposition was started at room temperature. Due to the process heat, the substrate temperature rises up to 170 centigrade. Increasing zinc content results in the generation of bumps and roughening the layer surface. Reaching a critical temperature, zinc grains begin to agglomerate. This can be explained by their tendency to minimize their internal energy. The samples in the lower row were processed at a higher starting temperature. By increasing the initial temperature, the surface becomes smoother, zinc grains show a more fine dispersive distribution, and zinc concentration is reduced. It can be assumed that a remarkable re-evaporation of zinc already occurs during deposition. Now we have to check if the zinc component can be removed almost completely. This diagram shows the mass loading for a pure silicon deposition on side-by-side arranged substrates. The mass loading represents the ratio of layer mass and coated area. Consequently, it corresponds to the layer thickness, which get a maximum directly over the silicon vapor source. The purple curve represents the data for a silicon zinc compound layer. Due to the heavy zinc, the absolute mass loading is increased, and the maximum is shifted in the direction of the zinc vapor source. The inset micrograph shows that a fine dispersed distribution of zinc grains were achieved. Zinc grains were visualized by the bright areas. The green curve represents the data for a silicon zinc compound layer after thermal annealing. The data demonstrates that zinc is expelled almost completely, and mass loadings of nearly pure silicon layers are obtained. The SEM micrograph shows, instead of the former zinc grains, pores are generated. This is represented by the dark regions in the lower inset. We checked the suitability of the fabricated porous silicon films as anodes in lithium-ion batteries and obtained encouraging results. This was already published in past, but this is not the focus of this talk. Rather, I would like to keep an eye of the results for the other tested materials. This diagram shows the mass loading for pure nickel in green triangles and for zinc in red circles. The curves represent the corresponding fits from the measured evaporation rates. As shown before, the maximum is reached directly over the vapor sources. The orange diamond symbols represent the data for a nickel zinc compound layer. By the way, this represents a maximum static deposition rate of ca. 130 nanometers per second. As you may see from the open diamond symbols, after vacuum annealing, samples with a higher zinc content show a reduced mass loading. This indicates that the ability for expelling zinc depends on the initial material compositions. To understand this effect, we carried out further analytical characterization on samples located at the marked positions. This slide shows corresponding XRD spectra from S-deposited layers. From peak position, the correlating phase was determined. To understand the dealing mechanism, one has to recapitulate the nickel-zinc phase diagram. For a zinc-rich composition, we start at the gamma phase and end at the alpha solid solution. With a medium zinc concentration, a comparable path will be taken. In case of low zinc concentration, the tendency for expelling zinc is reduced because the composition is more stable at higher temperature. Therefore, the beta-1 and alpha solid solution would be expected. This is a simplified interpretation because the displayed phase diagram is valid for atmospheric pressure only, and the phase transition via vaporization is not considered. Nevertheless, the identified structure by XRD spectra coincide with the expected one from compositions. We got phases of beta 1 and alpha solid solutions for the initial low zinc concentrations, and for initial higher zinc concentration, annealing results in an alpha solid solution only. On the upper part of this slide, there is shown the surface morphology of the S-deposited samples. With varying the zinc concentration, no major differences can be identified on the surface. The visible trenches result from plasma pretreatment of the stainless steel substrate. During etching process, the material removal is increased at the grain boundaries, resulting in roughing the substrate surface. Whereas in SEM micrographs at cross sections, a grain refinement can be seen with decreasing zinc content. The grain sizes ranges from approximately 0.5 micrometer to some nanocrystallites. This slide shows SEM micrographs of corresponding samples after annealing. As previously, the upper part reveals the surface morphology and the lower part the cross sections. With initially higher zinc concentrations, the porosity is more pronounced. The re-evaporation of zinc is preferred at the substrate's grain boundaries and results in an open porosity. A grain growth can be obtained at all samples. Last but not least, I want to present the results of experiments with carbon. Carbon sublimates, and therefore there is no need for using a crucible. As evaporation material, we used graphite bricks, which is shown on the left-hand side. As previously, the diagram shows the mass loading for pure carbon as black triangles and for zinc as red circles. The brown diamond symbols represent the data for a carbon-zinc compound layer as deposited, and the open brown diamond symbols illustrate the data after annealing. As one can see from the reduced mass loading, zinc seems to be expelled more or less, depending on the initial zinc concentration. On this slide, the SEM micrographs from S-deposited carbon-zinc layers shows that the reaching a critical temperature, zinc grains begin to agglomerate. This results in the generation of bumps and roughing the layer surface. Furthermore, a whisker-like structure of the zinc crystallites is formed on the coating surface. By annealing at 500 centigrade, zinc crystallites on surface will be removed and the remaining surface appears almost unchanged. In reality, a reordering effect takes place and the remaining zinc agglomerates are deformed to a lens shape. Depending on the initial zinc concentration, zinc was expelled almost completely. This can be visualized in more detail by this magnified micrograph. For a low initial zinc concentration, the remaining zinc is visible by bright lens-shaped areas, whereas for higher initial zinc content on the right-hand side, a larger amount of voids are generated. Let's summarize the results. I presented an experimental setup for co-evaporation of materials together with zinc to deposit a compound layer with static deposition rates up to 100 nanometers per second. The zinc concentration could be changed systematically. Depending on the process parameters, the layer morphology ranges from a fine dispersed distribution of the zinc crystallites up to zinc agglomeration with bumps. By a subsequent terminal annealing under vacuum, the zinc component could be expelled almost completely and voids were generated. For the nickel reorder mechanism, the phase change were evaluated by XRD. This demonstrated the feasibility to produce porous layers out of silicon, nickel, or carbon by an innovative approach with vacuum processing. But the results offer also space for optimization concerning the process conditions and detailed understanding of morphology formation. These optimization aspects are pointed out here in the outlook. One important point is adapting the technology to further materials. Actually, we are working on a research project for co-deposition of silicon-lithium layers. they should work as pre-lithiated silicon anode for lithium ion batteries. The advantage of this process is that the annealing procedure can be skipped and therefore sensitive substrate materials such as plastic films can be used. In the recently started project, we use a special equipped R&D tool called Versa, which is suitable for the upcoming task. It offers the possibility to handle critical materials like lithium under inert atmosphere. In the experiments, we want to produce special compound layers and we want to investigate their battery performance. The Fraunhofer FEP is now looking forward to collaborating with manufacturers to transfer the results into high-performance products. I want to acknowledge my colleagues for their assistance and I want to thank the Free State of Saxony and the European Union for funding. And I want to thank you for your kind